now we are going to again revisit topic on demand, okay, but now we are going to do it using the concept that we have learned in the chapter of consumer theory, okay. So, what we have learned in the consumer theory, that consumer tries to maximize his utility given his budget constraint. If I say, of course, in very, you know, in mathematical and precise way to say it, but this is what we have learned, okay. When you solve it, when you solve this, you know, what do? We solve for x 1 star and x 2 star, fine. If you pay attention to this, x 1 star, x 1 and x 2 are variable, okay. Utility function depends on the preference of this particular person. What kind of parameter we have? The parameters are p 1, p 2 and I. By the way, what are the parameters? What do I mean by parameters? Variable givens, a parameter is a variable, but it is beyond the control of the user, beyond the control of consumer in this context. And also parameters do not change in the short period of time. But of course, all the interesting results that we are going to get, we will get by varying the parameters, okay. So, what we get, x 1 star is basically a function of p 1, p 2 and I, and similarly x 2 star is also a function of p 1, p 2 and I. In other words, consumption of good 1 is given as function of its price and some other parameters. Right now, we are not worried about some other parameters. And what is this? The optimal consumption. This is the optimal consumption. If this is your optimal consumption, it means that this is basically quantity demanded of good 1 as a function of its price. If you here, if you give the value of p 2 and I and leave p 1 in the variable form, what do we get? The quantity demanded as function of this price. So, basically this is what? Demand curve. So far what we have been doing basically, that we have been deriving the demand curve using preferences, using some building blocks that we have discussed in the this particular chapter, but the ultimate aim was to derive the demand curve, and that is what we have done, okay. So, can you just, for example, if you go back, if you have solved, when goods are perfect substitute, let us say we are talking about two good world, where good 1 and good 2 are perfect substitute. Perfect substitutes. In this case, the demand function for good 1 can be given as this particular function. This is equal to I divided by p 1 when, and perfect substitute, of course, one thing I am leaving out here, that perfect substitute in 1-to-1 ratio, because perfect substitutability does not ensure that the exchange is 1:1. So, I am saying here 1-to-1 ratio. So, this is going to be I divided by p 1 when p 1 is less than p 2, and anything between 0 and I p 1 when p 1 is equal to p 2 and 0 if p 1 is greater than p 2. This is what we observe.
Point out, you are seeing that the perfect substitutions are those who are in 1-to-1 ratio, but when we take the example of bread and butter, they were in the ratio of 1:2.
No, I didn't say that they have to be in the 1-to-1 ratio. I am saying here that here the example that we are taking, good 1 and good 2 are perfect substitute and they are in 1-to-1 ratio. What is the definition that I gave for the perfect substitute? That two goods are perfect substitute for a consumer if he is willing to exchange one good for the other good in the fixed ratio. That ratio can be anything, 1:2, 2:1, anything. But here I am saying for this example that he is willing to exchange good 1 for good 2 in 1-to-1 ratio. Okay. In that case, this is the demand function we will get. Is it clear? And that is how we obtain demand function. Okay. So, now let us see, let us do a simple experiment. Here we have, let us say these are the indifference curve, these are the indifference curve, fine, they are parallel, assume that these are parallel. Okay. Now, let us say this is the budget constraint, sorry, this is the budget constraint. Okay. Now, of course, it all depends on the value. Let us say if they are perfect substitute, their utility will be given by this equation, and budget constraint will be P1 x1 P2 x2 should be less than I. Now, what we do? We will start increasing P1, what will happen? When we start increasing P1, how would it become? Or you can say, let us start decreasing in this scenario, particular scenario, start decreasing P1. How would it look like? From here, we will move to this. We will have anti-clockwise rotation pivoted at the maximum amount of good 2 possible. Is it clear? So, what I am saying, of course, I did not give you value and randomly I had drawn that P1 plus P2 x2 is equal to I is going to be a straight line and I do not know where it will be. I have drawn something randomly. But now, if we increase, let us say this blue line gives this budget line. What happens if we decrease the price of good 1? This point represents the maximum amount of good 2 that you can buy if this is your budget line, and this is the maximum amount of good 1 that you can buy. So, if P1 is decreasing and P2 is remaining the same, this point will not change, this point will not change and this will shift, and we know that two points are sufficient to draw the straight line. So, the new budget line is going to be like this and then it is going to be like this and so on. Fine. Okay. From here, what we are basically doing? We are varying the price. By varying price, basically what we are doing? I just told you the mathematically, but I am telling you here graphically that we are obtaining the optimal consumption bundle. If we keep on decreasing the price of good 1, let us say in this graph according to this graph at this price, the person is buying only good 2. But as we start decreasing the price of good 1, what will happen? There will be a point where this person would start buying good 1 and he will keep on buying the amount of good 1. So, how will the optimal bundle look like? Here, either in this zone or it is in somewhere in this zone. After it becomes flatter than this. And then what we are doing here, that here we keep x 1 as it is and we put P 1 here. Of course, by solving it mathematically, we obtain x 1 star is a function of x 1 star p 1 p 2 and I, and it so happened in this case that x 1 star is largely independent of p 2, okay? It depends only on p 1. So, now we have to transplant these points in this graph, and when we do it, how would it look like? That above certain point we do not know, let us say above we do not know, it depends on value of a, b and p 2. So, we can say above certain point there will be no demand, okay. At p 1, what is going to happen? Somewhere from 0 to I p 1, something like this, and after this what will happen? Something like this. So, what do we get? Basically the demand schedule or demand curve. And how about a curve denoting the curve passing through all the optimal bundles that we have obtained by decreasing the price of good one? If we chart those the bundles, then what do we get is price consumption curve. The name is price consumption curve, there are other names also. So, we obtain price consumption curve. Of course, this will be the given by blue dotted lines, blue dotted lines. Of course, here it is on x axis, but why? Because on y axis we have good 2 and all those points good 2, amount of good 2 consumed is 0. So, that is why we get all these points on the x axis, but here on y axis we have price of good 1, and on x axis we have amount of good 1, and this is what we obtain. So, basically we end up getting the demand curve, fine.